Hello, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Dr. Kam Tim Chan, coming from Queen Elizabeth Hospital of Hong Kong. Welcome you all to this complex PCI case presentation section. This section, we have an expert panel consisting of Dr. Paul Chine, Dr. Afla Haroon, and Dr. Kun Meng Lun. And we have altogether six presenters coming from different parts of the world. So without further ado, may I introduce our first presenters. Our first presenter is Dr. Brian Rene Tonodano, coming from the Medical City of Philippines. The presentation topic is percutaneous pulmonary balloon valvuloplasty in carcinoid heart disease with bioprosthetic transcatheter valve. So Dr. Tonodano, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's my honor to be part of this year's TCTAP conference. And I'll be presenting a simple case of percutaneous pulmonic balloon valvuloplasty in a rare carcinoid heart disease with bioprosthetic tricuspid valve, which makes it quite unique. In behalf of the team, I'm Brian F. Toledano from the Medical City, Philippines. We have nothing to disclose at the moment. My objective is to present the use of multi-imaging modalities for pre- and post-operative evaluation and to describe the steps that led to a successful procedure. Our patient is a 52-year-old woman with stage 4 carcinoid tumor and multiple hepatic metastasis, diagnosed since 2014. She already underwent multiple treatments, first was ileal dissection and mesenteric excision for the primary tumor, followed by transarterial chemoembolizations and selective radiation therapy of the liver for the metastasis. In 2018, she was supposed to undergo cytoreductive hepatectomy, but was deferred due to symptomatic severe tricuspid regurgitation and stenosis. And so a tricuspid bioprosthetic valve replacement was done. After the surgery, she had carcinoid crisis, and fortunately, she was able to recover and was discharged. Mid last year, she again experienced easy fatigability, and on examination, a new murmur was heard. Her 5-hydroxyendoloacetic acid was elevated as expected. A normally functioning bioprosthetic tricuspid valve was seen on echocardiogram, but on interrogation of the pulmonary valve, a mosaic color flow display was seen throughout systole with a peak velocity of 4.6 meters per second and a mean gradient of 86, consistent with severe pulmonic valve stenosis. This recent diagnosis precluded her from undergoing a hepatic resection, so an open heart versus percutaneous pulmonary valve intervention was contemplated, and the less invasive percutaneous balloon valvuloplasty was favored due to her previous incidence of carcinoid crisis. We started to plan the procedure by measuring the pulmonic valve annulus. A 24 millimeter length was obtained using cardiac computed tomography scan. So we proceeded with the procedure. A mild sedation and local anesthesia were given. We were very careful in crossing the bioprosthetic tricuspid valve to avoid possible complications. And luckily, it was accomplished just by using pigtail catheter with the straight end of the J-wire. On RV-gram, the ventricle appears to be hypertrophied. The pulmonary valve appears to be thickened and stenotic. A jet of contrast is seen going to a small orifice doming valve. There was also post-stenotic dilation of the pulmonary arteries. The stenotic pulmonic valve was crossed using the thermoglide wire supported by 7 French DR5 catheter. The initial PA pressure obtained was 19 over 15, and RV pressure was 80 over 8 with a gradient of 61 upon pullback. An amplet stiff wire was introduced as an exchange and advanced deep into the left PA. An initial smaller valvuloplasty catheter size 23 millimeter was inflated. The PA to RV pullback gradient decreased from 61 to 24 millimeter mercury. We decided to do a second inflation using a larger PTV catheter size 26 millimeter, which is actually the length of pulmonic valve annulus from the CT scan. A pullback gradient of 3 millimeter mercury was achieved. On repeat, RV-gram, markedly improved mobility of the valve leaflets with larger valve orifice was seen. Post-operative transthoracic echocardiogram showed mild pulmonic stenosis and regurgitation. The TAPSE was low but may be confounded by the presence of the bioprosthetic valve. The more important parameters such as RVS prime, RVFAC, longitudinal strain, mean gradient peak velocity, and diastolic PA pressure all improve. Her functional class also returned to normal, and after 6 months, she finally underwent a successful cytoreductive hepatectomy. For my discussion, as we all know, the prognosis of this disease is said to be grim, but she had survived well past the expected median survival, currently 8 years from the diagnosis of metastasis and 4 years from the diagnosis of the carcinoid heart. The gold standard for valve problems in this case is still surgical valve replacement over percutaneous valvuloplasty due to the high recurrence rate, but a less invasive procedure was considered because of her conditions, making her a high-risk candidate for reduced surgical valve replacement. Transcatheter pulmonary valve replacements have already been reported in this kind of situation. However, this expertise is not yet available in our country. A few case reports have already described the success of PPPV for immediate symptom relief and bridge to liver surgery. And in our knowledge, this is the first case in which a bioprosthetic tricuspid valve is already present at the time of procedure. For my conclusion, carcinoid heart is with hepatic metastasis is a rare disease that variably affects the tricuspid and pulmonic valves. CT scan is an invaluable tool to measure the pulmonic valve annulus for proper balloon sizing, and this procedure carries a lower risk for crisis, immediately improves echocardiographic parameters of the right ventricle, and acts as a bridge for hepatic cytoreductive surgery. And in the presence of bioprosthetic tricuspid valve, careful advancement of wires, catheters is important to avoid entanglement. And finally, a gradual step-up of balloon size should be done to avoid rupture and to achieve disaggregation for symptom relief. That's my last slide. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Tony Dano, for your excellent presentation. Is there any comment from our expert panelists? Yes, maybe I start off. Dr. Tony Dano, do you have any bailout if the balloon dilatation results in severe pulmonary regurgitation? Do you have any bailout procedure for that? Or what's the chances of having a severe pulmonary regurgitation after the balloon?
That's one of the possible complications. And if ever that happened, I think we'll probably proceed with the open heart cardiac surgery. But knowing the disease, carcinoid syndrome per se, is more likely to develop stenosis than regurgitation. So we were lenient with the balloon dilatation, and we were confident that the annulus length seen in the CT scan was the appropriate size for the balloon.
Okay. So as you mentioned, maybe a bailout, a melody valve, the percutaneous pulmonary valve replacement may be an option if you got that facility available.
Yes, in our settings, sir, we don't have that expertise yet.
Do we have any other comment from our panelists? Paul, do you have any comment?
Yeah, I can ask. So, was there any problem crossing the bioprosthetic valve at all? I mean, if it's there, although it's a bioprosthetic valve, it may be quite easy to cross because the blood flow is in the direction of when the leaflets open. So, what was your experience during the case?
We were expecting that the crossing would be difficult, but fortunately, we were able to cross it with ease. But we were very careful in the bioprosthetic valve not to injure it.
All right.
For the neck, the mechanism of the stenosis, what do you all think it was in this patient?
Well, for the carcinoid syndrome, and based on the CT scan, the etiology was from the thickened valve annulus and the valve per se, because the presence of serotonin receptors are in those areas, the valve especially.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Tony Dano, for your excellent presentations. May I invite our next presenters, Dr. Yilin Chai coming from Taipei Veteran General Hospital from Taiwan. The topic is severe iatrogenic aortic dissection resolved in 5 days after aortal osteostenting. Dr. Chai, please.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Chai from Taiwan. And I renamed my case by falling down at the last minute of CTO PCI. And I'm a member of structural team and PCI. I have nothing to disclose. And it was a 65-year-old woman who suffered tinnitus for months. And we have done the ECG show diffuse ST depression. And the non-invasive test, the sodium scan, revealed the LAD territory ischemia over 88%. And the TID ratio was very high. We entered coronary angiogram, and this coronary artery angiogram. And this was her left coronary artery angiogram. The cranial view revealed LAD territory was totally occluded. So overall, we can notice that she had a right coronary artery osteocalcified plaque with Lehmann distal shaped stenosis and LAD chronic total occlusion, and it was start osteo. So her synthesis score was very high, it's 52 points. And we suggest CABG for his coronary artery disease treatment, but our patient refused. So for intervention, our strategy was to treat the right coronary artery first, then we can have the retrograde option to revascularize her LAD CTO. For the osteo lesion, because of the calcified plaque, we tried the cutting balloon, but severe spiral dissection happened during the RCO osteo PCI. So we secured with 3 long drug eluting stents. And the final angiogram of RCA was quite good with the collateral perfusing to the left LAD. After the right coronary artery intervention, she felt better but still have effort-related angina because the ischemia was totally at the LAD territory. So we arranged CTO PCI after 2 months. And this was the contralateral injection. We can see that the LAD total occluded was quite long. The JTC score was about 3 points. And because of the right coronary cusp, the injury healed. So retrograde was not considered for the LAD CTO PCI. So the only way we had was the IRAS guide to identify the osteoproximal cap and the anti-KY escalation. So after checking the IRAS image to locate entry point, we start with the CTOY part A and escalated to Gaia second because of the calcified plaque. Then because of the Gaia second still was cannot enter the treatment, escalated 12. And luckily, fortunately, we can manage the conquest port 12 to the LAD distal. And after the Gaia entering the LAD distal vessel and check the IVAS. And we can confirm our guide wire was all in the true lumen. And the Lehmann shaped, distal shaped had about 60% stenosis and the plaque burden was relatively low. So we decided to perform the provisional Lehmann to LAD stenting with 2 drug eluting stents. Up to the typical Lehmann bifurcation technique, part, KBT and part. The final angiogram, the LAD flow was quite good. But when we take the final angio shot, we note that the ascending was dissection. And at that time, our patient complained acute, sharp chest pain. We checked the IVAS image and showed our proximal stent edge was dissection. And the hematoma to the aorta and the cusp. So we deployed another drug eluting stent to save the Lehmann proximal stent edge dissection. And in order to confirm the dissection flap was sealed, we checked the IVAS and we can see that the stent was minimal protruded. And so our dissection flap was totally covered. And the final angiogram revealed no more contrast extravasated to the ascending aorta. And after the PCI, we sent her to the CT room. And we can see that the ascending aorta was dissection extension to the aortic arch. And this was the Downing criteria type grade 3 aortic dissection. And surgery was recommended in this type of aortic dissection because the potential of aorta rupture or stroke. However, at that time, our Hartin discussion, our surgeon said surgical treatment is required for service, but conservative treatment may success because of the inlet of dissection was covered. And our patient decided not to choose surgery because her symptom was totally relieved after the DS implantation. So we use the drug, nicardipine pump and beta blocker to reduce the heart rate and control her blood pressure. After 5 days, we follow up the CT angiogram and revealed the aortic dissection was resolved. So for my case, I have 3 points to share. The first one was the unawareness of stent edge dissection and forceful contrast injection catastrophe during the compressed PCI. Second, severe iatrogenic aortic dissection usually requires surgery to avoid aorta rupture, stroke, or other fatal complications. Finally, if we can identify entry point clearly by IVAS, even a severe iatrogenic aortic dissection can be successfully treated by stent implantation and medical therapy. And moreover, the heart team discussion and shared decision making is important for this case because our cardiosurgeon told us maybe conservative treatment may work. And our patient decided not to receive the surgery for treatment because her symptom was totally received. And heart teamwork is quite important during the complex PCI and complication management. And this is my case. Thank you for your listening.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Chai, for your excellent presentation. Very complex cases. Any comment from our panelists?
Yes, I want to ask. Okay, it's a very great case, Dr. Chai. I want to ask, what are the indication that you didn't send patient for surgery? Why you choose the conservative management first?
Because actually the surgical indication is that is Downing 3 aortic dissection, iatrogenic dissection. And if the dissection is progressed, the aorta may rupture and then patient may die after PCI. So at first we consulted our surgeon, but the reason why we choose the conservative treatment is the dissection flap was sealed by our second drug eluting stent at the landmark. And we confirmed the dissection flap was totally sealed by IVAS. So our surgeon said it could be 50% to succeed treated by conservative treatment. And moreover, the symptom was relieved.
Yeah.
Because our patient suffered from acute chest sharp pain when the dissection happened. And the symptom relief after we seal the dissection plate. And we inform our patient the risk of aorta rupture if we don't choose the surgery. And she totally accepted that because he don't want to have an open heart surgery.
Yes, thank you. I think clinical monitoring and the progress of the patient is very important factors. All right, we're very close monitoring. As you mentioned, the symptom improved. If the patient deteriorate or increasing worsening chest pain or further progression of the dissection by imaging, then maybe you can reconvince the patient or talk to the surgeon again. There's still a chance that the patient can be scheduled for surgery. All right.
Thank you.
So it's a very good case. Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Chai. As time running short, may I introduce our next presenters, Dr. Ha-Yun Lo, again coming from Taiwan, from the National Taiwan University Hospital. Dr. Lo is going to present to us the management of intramural hematoma after stenting. Dr. Lo, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ha-Yun Lo from National Taiwan University Hospital. And today I will present a case, 79 years old male suffered from dyspnea and chest tightness for 6 months. The medical history of this patient included peripheral artery disease, epidemia, and hypertension. The ECG showed sinus reason. There was transition zone counterclockwise rotation, suspect lateral wall ischemia. The chest X-ray showed cardiomegaly with clear lung field. And we also arranged myocardial perfusion scan with diaphragmal stress test for this patient. And the result showed reduced flow reverse at mid-inferior wall and subendocardial scar at basal, anterolateral, and inferior lateral walls. And the coronary artery angiography showed LAD middle 70% stenosis, collateral to circumflex and RCA. And the circumflex proximal was CTO lesion with JCTO score 1. And RCA middle was also CTO lesion with JCTO score 0. And in this condition, we consult cardiological surgery doctors for bypass surgery, but the patient refused surgery. So we performed PCI to this patient. So first target was proximal to middle, to distal circumflex, the CTO lesion. And we performed PCI through left artery with six French EVU 3.5 guiding catheter. And we wire Sion to LAD and wire Gassican to circumflex CTO lesion with fine cross microcaster support. We use microcaster tip injection to check the distal flow condition. And we switch Gassican to run-through floppy and perform predilated with compound balloon. We check IVAS. The IVAS image shows the wire was in true lumen. And we also use IVAS image to evaluate the stent landing zone and vessel size. We performed predilated with compound balloon again. And this is the circumflex flow before stenting. However, before our stenting, the wire was removed accidentally. We rewired with round through to circumflex quickly and deployed a dry and loading stent to proximal to distal circumflex. But after stenting, the distal circumflex flow became worsened. So we checked IVAS. IVAS showed the wire and stent was over true to false to true lumen and with intramural hematoma formation. The stent proximal part was in true lumen, but it was underexpanded. So we performed post-dilated with NC balloon to stem proximal part and use a cutting balloon for intramural hematoma and false lumen stenting. And after cutting balloon use, distal circumflex flow become better. And in IVAS image, the intramural hematoma gets smaller. And the stent was well expanded in every part. We shift to next target, proximal to middle LAD. And we also use IVAS to evaluate the stent landing zone and vessel size. And perform predilated with non-compliant balloon. And this is LAD before stenting. Then we deployed a dry and loading stent to proximal to middle LAD. And perform postdilated with NC balloon. IVAS image showed the stent was well expanded. The flow was good. So we closed the procedure. So wires root true false true lumen is not rare in CTO lesion. Measurement of stent in true false true lumen with intramural hematoma formation have not been well studied. And we performed the case with this condition and successfully treated with IVAS guided fenestration with cutting balloon. So this is my conclusion. The cutting balloon could be useful for stent in true false true lumen with intramural hematoma formation. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Lo, for your presentation of this complicated case. Do I invite my panelists to give any comment? Dr. Nguyen, is Dr. Nguyen here? Do you have any comment on this case or any questions you would like to ask Dr. Lo? Well, yes, Dr. Lo, what's the size of cutting balloon that you choose in dealing with this complication? The size of the cutting balloon?
The size is the same as the stent, 2.5, yes.
So you use a 1-to-1 artery ratio?
Yes.
Paul, do you have any comment?
Yeah, I missed out, but when you first did the IVAS before you implanted the stent, did you already see that it was a true, false, true lumen? Because I wasn't sure of that part.
Before stenting, because we removed the wire accidentally. So after we rewire, we didn't recheck IVAS.
Okay.
So after stenting, we found the distal flow become worsened and we checked IVAS and then we found we wired true to false to true lumen. Yes.
So you we don't know that the first wire was it, whether it was truly whether it could have been just all true lumen at the very first wire, the one that crossed the CTO.
Sorry,
because you don't have an IVAS right after the crossing, right?
Yeah.
It's only the second wire that might have gone true false true, not the first wire.
First, we through the CTO lesion when we check IVAS, the IVAS showed the wire was in true lumen.
Okay.
After we rewired, maybe there is a dissection or we wired true false true lumen. Yeah, this is a complication. Yes.
I mean, the lesson to learn is that when you lose the guy wire and then rewire again, it's better for you to be checked with IVAS.
It's better. Yes. Recheck okay. Important. Yeah. Thank you.
All right. If there are no more comments, then thank you very much, Dr. Lo, for your excellent presentations. I invite our next presenters? The topic is fever and hemoptysis as rare presenting symptoms of acute aortic dissection. It's going to be presented by Dr. Tanvir Panvala, coming from the National Heart Institute of Malaysia. Dr. Panvala, please.
Thank you, Dr. Chan. I'm Dr. Tanvir Iqbal Panvala from Institute Jantung Negara Malaysia. I'm going to talk about fever and hemoptysis as rare presenting symptoms of acute aortic dissection. Okay, I have no potential conflict of interest. My patient was a 55-year-old gentleman who had comorbids of diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and also had a CABG in 2016 and renal calculi with a stent in situ. His main complaint was intermittent chest pain for 1 month. On admission, we noticed that he has persistent fever and recurrent hemoptysis. Otherwise, his heart and lung was unremarkable. Because of his previous bypass, he also had past history of being admitted to other hospital with same complaints, fever and hemoptysis, in which he was given a course of IV antibiotics and TB workup also was negative. So since he has a bypass graft, we proceeded with MSCT coronary and graft study, which showed that all these grafts were patent. However, incidentally, we found that there was a thoracic aortic dissection. As it was not very clear on the MSCT, we further proceeded with a CT angiogram. And the CT angiogram shows that there was a concealed active leak of a focal aortic dissection in the descending thoracic aorta, just beneath the carina until where the coronary sinus enters the right atrium. The leak was surrounded by thrombus hematoma with overall diameter of 7.2 times 8 times 7.2. And there was also an aberrant right subclavian artery. So this is the image of the aortic dissection. And this is the how the lumen has become narrowed because of the thrombus hematoma. This is the three levels, and this is the 3D reconstruction of, and we can see that there is the aortic dissection here and also the right aberrant subclavian artery. The next day after the CT angiogram, patient develops sudden massive hemoptysis, and due to persistent fever, an impending mycotic aneurysm rupture was suspected, and patient was stabilized and brought to immediately to the invasive cardiovascular lab for emergency TWAR. Patient was intubated and sedated, and bilateral femoral access was obtained and Terumo 6F sheet used. JR 3.56F diagnostic catheter with Terumo wire inserted in the right femoral artery, and pigtail catheter was inserted in the left femoral artery. So the Centrance introducer sheet, 18 French, was inserted in on the right femoral artery. Terumo wire was exchanged with the stiff backup Meyer wire, guide wire. Pigtail catheter was used to locate the A level of the dissection and also the aberrant right coronary, right subclavian artery origin, and determine the proximal landing zone. Then we used a stent valence 26 mm, 152 mm size was deployed after the aberrant right subclavian artery origin, and pigtail catheter was also used to locate the origin of celiac artery to decide the distal landing zone. Then we implanted another stent valence to extend it until the level of T11, just before the celiac artery origin at T12, and good results were seen. Right femoral access was closed with two perclosed proglide closure device, and left femoral artery access was closed with proglide, and total contrast use was 200 mils. Okay, CT angiogram post 1 week and post 3 months show no endo leak. Pre-procedure patient had persistent fever in the ward, and he was he was treated with IV antibiotics, referred to the infectious disease team, patient was, but however, whenever we did the blood cultures and urine cultures, they were always showed no growth in this patient. DB screening also was done and was never positive in this patient. So the point I want to say is that that the literature shows that fever can be a very presenting complaint in presentation in acute aortic dissection. And in which case we found that there is a lot of negative microbiological tests. And the possible cause of this fever is not due to infection, but because of inflammatory response to the aortic dissection. Hemoptysis also develops due to the autobronchial fistula between the aortic dissection and the adjacent bronchus. We had a bronchoscopy done for the patient, and we found that after the procedure, there was a fistula by which closed off. And we found that after the procedure, patient's hemoptysis slowly resolved. Okay, so although rare, the acute aortic dissection can present with fever with of unknown origin and hemoptysis. For example, this paper, which is a REF SCSP cardiology Spanish paper in 2010, showed that he studied 59 cases. They studied 59 cases, retrospective analysis of type B aortic dissection, and they found that they have fever. And they also give some proposals of how will you differentiate if the fever is because of an infection or is because of the inflammatory of the aortic dissection? So there was some recommendation that they put in their paper telling that the fever would be more like it will begin 48 to 72 hours after clinical symptoms. Fever lasts for more than 96 hours. Variation in the daily temperature will be less than 1.2, and patient will be in good general conditions. And then fever does not remit after 48 hours with antibiotics. Like just like our case, a patient fever was unresolving. We were doing repeated blood CNS, but it didn't show any. But because we were afraid our graft will get infected, he was still covered with antibiotics after the procedure. Also, hemoptysis is an unusual presenting complaint of descending aortic aneurysm dissection. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Campbella. Very interesting presentations, all right, for the acute aortic dissection. Any comment from our panelists? Yes, Dr. Campbella, you did a CT scan. So did your CT scan show any communication between the aorta and the bronchus, any aorto or bronchial fistula in your contrast CT scan?
Yeah, we can see that there is some some bronchus which is exactly adjacent to the level of dissection. I'm not sure whether the one I shared had the picture, but there was a level in which we can see that there is
okay.
There is a close proximity, not the true connection.
All right. Any other comments?
No, just a general question. Actually, it's a great case and wisely managed, but just I want to ask, what is the reason for persistent fever in such a case? You mentioned your patient had a persistent fever in spite of antibiotic given for a few days.
Yeah, because studies have shown that in acute aortic dissection, it is an inflammatory process, and this inflammatory process causes persistent fever. And what happens that people end up giving antibiotics and it doesn't respond. That literature that I just highlight also shows if you give endomethacin or anti-inflammatory drugs, it will respond more better. In the fever will respond more better rather than by giving antibiotics because it's actually not infectious in origin. There are reason for the fever is inflammatory rather than it's infection. That's why our antibiotics don't work in this kind of fever. It's more, that's why it's recommended in that paper that you give anti-inflammatory rather than giving the antibiotics in these cases. And they recommend few features that you can help you to differentiate that it is not infectious.
And you try
like
the anti-inflammatory.
Systemic inflammatory response. Yeah.
It's in the paper, it's mentioned endomethacin is much better, especially endomethacin.
And have you tried that one, endomethacin?
This literature I went through we had this case. So we didn't really use, but I remember the infectious disease physician telling me that it's mostly inflammation that maybe is causing. That's why our antibiotics are not working on him.
Any other comments? If no, then thank you very much, Dr. Campbella. Very excellent presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
May I invite our next presenters, Dr. Hihi Ku, coming from Beijing Friendship Hospital from China. The topic is combining FFR and quantitative flow ratio, QFR, guided PCI in free vessel coronary artery lesions. Dr. Ku, please.
Okay, thank you for your introduction and good afternoon, dear professors, ladies and gentlemen. I'm He He Cui. It is my great pleasure to present this case at TCT 2022 conference. These are my disclosures. Now, my case is a 59 years old male, and his chief complaint is a transient episode of rest tightness. The tightness can be radiated to left arm and last almost 30 minutes, and it was relieved automatically, had no recent symptoms of exertional angina, and he was not restricted to in physical exercise. He has risk factors of hypertension and type 2 diabetes mellitus. Also, he is a smoker and has a history of hyperuricemia. There is nothing special in his physical examination, and this is his admissional EKG. This showed almost normal. So because the atypical symptom, we tested coronary CT angiography first, and we find there is some severe stenosis in his LAD, LCX, and right coronary artery. Also, there is some calcification lesions. Also, there is no significant abnormality in his lab studies and lab studies. Also, we diagnosed this patient with unstable angina pectoris with a classification around 1-2. So we decided to put to test the coronary angiography. Now we can find that there is a right dominant distribution with the coronary totalicity and a 70 to 80% tubular stenosis in the distal LCX and a 70% to 80% diffuse stenosis in the proximal to mid LAD. And also there is a 19 to 95% local stenosis in the PDA and the subtotal occluded posterior lateral artery. So because the lesion in the LAD and LCX are intermediate lesions, so we tested FFR. And the lesions in the LAD, the FFR value is 0.79. And the QFR value is 0.83. And the value of LCX is 0.991. And the QFR value in LCX is 0.91. So because the rotary coronary artery is subtotal occluded in the PLA, so we only tested the QFR of the PDA. The value is 0.65. So we decided to do some PCI to PLA. We crossed the PLA with field XTR and predilation with 2.12 predilation balloon. And because the lesion is strongly calcified, so we use NC predilation, NC balloon to predilation. And we decided to use DCB to treat the lesion, but the predilation is not full, not very good. So we implanted 2.25 and 32 millimeter depth to the PLA. And this is the process of post-dilation. And we decided to treat, also we decided to treat the disease, the lesion in the PDA, and we predilated the disease with 2.12 and 2.5 and plus 9 millimeter NC balloon. We can also notice that the predilation is not very good, and the residual stenosis is very heavy. So we decided to implant another stent to the PDA. So this is the final result. And after that, we tested the QFR of the RCA, and we find that final QFR is 0.97. So the QFR is not broadly used in the world. However, the FEVER 2 study demonstrated that QFR had a good consistency with FFR. Also, we always consider FFR as the gold standard. In a recently published FEVER 3 China study, the patient undergoing PCI the strategy was changed. A QFR guided strategy of lesion selection improved 1 year clinical outcomes compared with the standard angiography guidance. Okay, regarding to this case, we find that QFR was used in torturous and extrinsic lesions in this case, avoiding wire manipulation and vessel dilator, hence it reduced the operational time and interventional risk. Also, we find that QFR for branches such as PDA and PLA could be assessed simultaneously. And also, QFR is acquired from angiographic runs and it is affected by image quality and the view angle, and it might increase contrast usage. In some extremely torturous lesions displayed and clearly in angiography, QFR test might be limited. In general, selective or combinational using FFR or QFR might improve the quality of PCI. Okay, this is my last advice. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Curry, for your very excellent presentation of this complex cases by using FFR together with QFR. Do we have any comment from our group of panelists?
Yes. Yes, but I think that is not a CTO reason, but why do you use Finder? Is the guy why it is more dangerous in the for the lesson in the area?
Thank you for your question. And yes, this is not a CTO. The lesion in the PLA is subtotally occluded because the CT scan have already showed that the lesion is quite calcified. So normal, we have already tried that some workhorse such as run through but failed. So we decide to use the failed XTR and with the guidance of microcatheter.
I ask, it's very nice software that you have. When you do the angiogram, how long does it take for the system to generate the QFR numbers for you?
Because the QFR machine is just an independent machine, just like IVAS or OCT. It is not combined combined to the angiography machine. So we should copy the runs and copy the angiography images to the QFR machine to calculate the QFR value. So, although the patient should wait for some minutes, but should avoid some other expenses.
Okay, it's time to run in short. Thank you very much, Dr. Curry, for your presentation.
You.
Okay. Well, may I invite our last presenters of today's sessions, Dr. Yaakob, coming from KPI, Kuala Lumpur, from Malaysia. And the topic for presentation is double steal phenomenon, a rare case of coronary fistula from LAD to main PA in the presence of SVG to LAD. Dr. Yaakob, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, distinguished expert panelists. I'm Zulhani, one of the cardiologists working in one of the private hospitals in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. My case is about 44-year-old lady who had a cleavage surgery in 2009, single vessel SVG to LAD only at another hospital. She's got background diabetes, hypertension, and she was admitted in July 2017 with chest pain. Top T negative and normal resting ECG, but she had a positive duovitamin stress echo at that time. We did an angiogram at that time and we found there was two lesions in the native in the LAD. We did a PCI with a stand via SVG and also we did a PCI to her mid circumflex with another stand as well. At that time, we noted there was a fistula from the proximal LAD into the main pulmonary artery. But the decision was made not to intervene on the fistula at the time because we thought the symptoms were likely due to the LAD and circumflex diseases. The SVG to LAD was widely patent at the time. This was in 2017. About 4 years later, she had worsening shortness of breath over 1 month. And at that time, we did a stress test and it was actually positive in early stage, you know, stage two. Echo was normal, and the normal pulmonary pressure was also normal. We actually did CTA this time first because she had received cabbage, and SVG to LAD was patent on the CT scan. But we noted there was actually a network of fistula, a large network of fistula from the LAD draining into the main pulmonary artery. So we brought her to the cath lab, and we did angiogram. This was on 20th of August last year. And as you can see, there's a large fistula draining into the main pulmonary artery. And there's a cranial view on the right side. You can see also a large network of fistula. And on this view, you can see there's no anti-grade flow at all from the proximal LAD. another view from the SVG, you can see widely patent stand in the LED that we did in 2017. And also there is the SVG into LED also drained into the fistula, also feeding into the fistula. So this is just a picture of the right coronary artery, which was unremarkable. So the conclusion was the stents in the LED and circumflex done in 2017 were patent, but there was actually worsening of the coronary artery fistula. Just to demonstrate that, I actually compared the picture. On the left side is actually done in 2017, and the right side on 2020. And you can see the significant increase in size of the network of the fistula in over 4 years' time. And another view, cranial view, okay, you can see there's a larger fistula in 2021. And this is a picture taken from the SVG, and you can see the significant larger size of the fistula in 2021. She had an open heart surgery, she had a CABG before, so of course she was not keen for another open heart surgery. So we decided to do percutaneous intervention to the fistula. We actually used Penumbra 2.7 French slim microcatheter into the feeder artery. And then we actually deployed two coils, 4 × 15 4 mm × 15 cm and 3 mm × 15 cm ruby coils into the fistula. There's a picture there, and this is actually the result. That's a pre-coiling, and on the right side is the post-coiling. You can see a significant reduction in the size of the fistula, although there's still a bit of flow there. And another picture to show the results, pre and post. Okay, so I just let that play for a few seconds. Okay, you can see there is a reduction in the size. So she actually, amazingly, she complained to me spontaneously. She felt immediate relief immediately after the procedure. And we repeated the stress test. It was, of course, much better. It was only stopped because she achieved a target heart rate. So the lesson to learn from this case was actually the indication and decision for the bypass surgery done at another hospital was controversial. My feeling at that time, I think the operator probably did the angiogram and saw there was a total occlusion of the proximal LED. And bear in mind, this was in 2009. So not many people are doing CTOs at the moment. So at that time, therefore she was actually referred for CABG. So although rare, coronary artery fistulas is actually an important cause of myocardial ischemia. In this case, the presence of SVG into the LED may have contributed to the progression of the fistula network of vessels due to increased flow from both anti-grade LED and also from the SVG to the LED anti-gradely and also retrogradely from the SVG. And this case also illustrated the success of percutaneous closure fistula using coiling device. With that, I thank you for your attention.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Yakub. Very interesting cases of the stubble steel phenomenon. All right, any comment from our panelists?
Yes, it's a very interesting and very good case, Dr. Yago. I have one question. Actually, I have three questions. Like the first one, why this fistula wasn't ligated at the time of surgery? But maybe because you mentioned the patient has done the surgery in other hospitals. But at the time when you did the angioplasty in 2017 and you found the fistula, and already you did a PCI to LED and circumflex, with putting in mind that the flow will increase and the fistula may expand, why you didn't consider to coil the fistula at that time?
At that time, we thought the symptom was mainly due to the disease. So it was a significant disease in the circumflex and LED. Of course, we didn't anticipate the fistula is going to get worse due to the SVG to LED. So we just entered the native arteries and we wanted to observe her over time. So that was a decision at that time.
Any other comments? Yeah.
Did you consider coiling from the SVG approach, because right now you still have one, so the fistula will always regrow and pressurize from wherever it comes in, right? So at the time, why not also do it at SVG to the fistula?
In that case, where do you want to put the coil? Still in the feeder from the proximal LED, right? Although you
No, I think you showed one angiogram with the SVG that was connecting retrograde, right?
Yep, correct. Yes.
I wonder if you can just push some coils in the retrograde to pack the fistula so that it will not recur again or repressurize from the retrograde.
I see. The SVG flow from the into the fistula was actually through the LAD as well. So SVG into the LAD and then went retrogradely to the fistula. So it was not a direct from SVG into the fistula. So I guess it's actually the same feeder, the same entry point of the from the proximal LAD anyway. Yeah.
So it's not two separate points coming from the LAD. I was wondering if it's a two separate entry point, one proximal and then a bit more distal where it's retrograde. Because a lot of times these fistulas have many feeder arteries.
Yep. In this case, they have a lot of feeder arteries, but a lot of feeder arteries are actually more distal. But to my eye, I didn't notice any direct communication from the SVG to the fistula. Otherwise, yes, okay. I think it's a good idea, like you suggested, we have to call it from the SVG as well. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Yakub.
Thank you.
Well, I think today we have six excellent presentations from our six interventional cardiologists over the world. And time is running short, so maybe we have to conclude here. Let me have this opportunity to thank our three expert panelists, Paul Cham, Dr. Haroon, and Dr. Loon. And thank you very much for all the excellent presentation from our six participants. And stay healthy and stay safe. Hope that we can see each other very soon in person. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.